Hello, I'm Sai. I currently work with LinkedIn, and I keep messing around with the data platforms that we have here. I've been doing this for the last 20 months over here. Previous to that, I was at Walmart, Yahoo, Akamai, and then StanChart. That's my email ID and the LinkedIn profile, and then that's my Flickr link if you want to look at the pictures I take. And that's one of the pictures where I hide my big tummy and the lack of hair that I have. So the talk that we are doing today is going to be about scaling distributed systems. Now, before I start the talk, I just want to let you in on a small secret. If someone ever tells you that the distributed system scales perfectly, they are actually lying. There is nothing like a perfectly scalable distributed systems. No matter what they do, it just doesn't scale all the time. Writing a proper code for a single system is hard enough. Getting it to work properly, scale it in a single machine is perfectly hard problem. Now, if you look at this analogy. That, by the way, is our dog, which is a perfectly nice dog. Most of the time that does listen to us, perfectly well behaved. And then one fine day when you go back to your house and then you see this complete mess. But then if you look at this, you know what the cause of the problem is. It's just that this single problem that is sitting around and you can address that. So when you talk about a single machine, let's say you run out of storage space, what do? You throw a new disk at it. Let's say you are running out of memory, what do? You throw more RAM at it. You're running out of processing power, what do? You upgrade the CPU or throw more cores at it. So when you look at a single machine, you most of the time you know what to do. It's pretty easy to understand that. But the problem starts taking a different turn when you start scaling horizontally instead of scaling vertically. For example, look at this. Now, you don't know what caused this. Is it moves which triggered, say, Mesa to break down everything? Now it becomes a vacuum hole. You don't know where the problem started, who caused it. It becomes a really tricky problem. And that, in essence, is what distributed systems is about. Scaling distributed systems is really, really tricky for one main reason, particularly stateful machines. Does anyone wants to guess what it is? It's primarily data, right? When you have a lot of data, what do? The biggest challenge that you have is moving all these pieces around. It takes a lot of time to move data around. And not just time, it takes a lot of resources to move stuff around. And that, in essence, is basically the biggest challenge that we have. So coming back to our talk, this is what we would be doing. The way I wanted to do this talk is basically present it as a case study. So Espresso is a NoSQL product that we have within LinkedIn. And the case study that we are going to be doing today is primarily based on Espresso. I'm not going to compare Espresso with any of the other NoSQL products that we have in the market right now. But all the learnings that I'm going to present will be based on Espresso. To make more sense out of it, I'm going to do a brief intro on Espresso, on how the architecture is, so that when we come back to the challenges and the approaches that we have taken, it would make more sense. And then we'll also look at some of the future changes that we are doing up ahead. So what is Espresso? Espresso is an online fault-tolerant key store that we have. It's a NoSQL. It supports multi-master subtype, so that we have writes coming in from all colos, syncing across all colos. So your data is available geographically. It bridges the case for RDBMS and key value store. We have a bunch of key value stores that are primarily in-memory stores, like Walmart and that. And then the traditional RDBMS, you know, like Oracle, MySQL and that. There was this use case about primarily getting out low response online queries out. Key value pairs that are in memory are really fast, but they don't take writes. And then when you put in the traditional RDBMS, they don't scale well. That's where Espresso fits in right now. And this is how Espresso would look in on a standard LinkedIn serving architecture. You have all the bunch of applications that access Espresso. It's HTTPS. I should have updated that. Now with GDPR, everything is on HTTPS. So Espresso basically takes online reads and writes. It has a change capture system that we internally call Brooklyn, which is based on Kafka. So all changes that come in into Espresso can be captured by the change capture system and can be used by stream processing for nearline serving. At the same time, we have an ability to import and export data into Hadoop, which can be used for offline data crunching. If you look at Espresso, primarily this is what Espresso is. We have a bunch of routers. These are just plain stateless HTTP proxies. All they do is receive requests, look at the incoming URL, figure out what the database is, and then they look at the partitioning key, or the primary key of the incoming request. They hash the incoming key to figure out which partition the database is in, and then send it to the appropriate storage node. All the storage nodes does is scatter, gather, in case of multi-request. Now, if you look at these routers, they tend to cache the system state information into memory, so that whenever there is a state change of partitions shuffling around, they route it to the appropriate node. Now, if you look at this in a slightly more in-depth, we have a bunch of storage nodes instead of a normal storage node, and the routers are doing scatter gather over the storage nodes. Now, every change that comes into the storage node is sent to Kafka. Now, if you look at the storage node, it is a Java API server that uses pluggable backend storage. But within LinkedIn, we use a MySQL with InnoDB storage for that. And MySQL also supports binlog transaction capture. The reason we use that is any request that comes in is written to binlog, which is then passed via open replicator and then sent into Kafka. So Kafka is what we use for replication both in colo and also as a source of truth for cross-colo replication. So any request that comes in onto the master as a write gets in into the MySQL. From there, it goes in into the binlog, where it gets converted into a Kafka stream, pushes to Kafka. And then we have another product, which is called Data Replicator, which basically reads off this Kafka stream for all the change captures and is responsible for replicating data cross-colo. And Data Replicator in itself is a stateless product. Yeah, all it does is it just takes a particular partition that it is responsible for and then just reads the data, replicates it to whatever destination it is supposed to replicate. Now, if you look at this, the whole cluster brain of this whole system is basically Helix. What Helix is basically a cluster management solution. What it does is it looks at each of these services that we have, manages the states on them, decides who gets what. For example, you look at a data replicator. You might have a DB that has 1,000 partitions on it, and you have a 50-odd node cluster. So what do? The Helix basically just picks up random partitions, assigns it to random nodes, decides who runs what. Now, if a particular node dies, each of these Helix would recognize that the node is down and then basically redirects a different node to pick out on the partition. And most of these applications, they maintain their state in the ZooKeeper so that in case a particular node dies, the state is still maintained for the upcoming node to pick it up. Yeah. And then we also have a snapshot service that is meant for offline processing. A lot of applications in LinkedIn had a requirement for ETL data, and that was our solution for that. So every storage node by default takes a backup on a daily basis, which is generally a full backup. This backup is, the backup information is again stored in ZooKeeper, which is then picked off from the snapshot service. It crunches this data to generate a plain ETL format in an Avro format, and then pushes it to Hadoop. In addition to that, snapshot is also used for offline processing and additional functionality on the Espresso cluster. For example, we do have a functionality of auto expiry of data. So whenever someone creates a record, they can set it to expire after X number of days. So automatically when a record expires, snapshot service would recognize that these records has expired on a given day and would create an expiry job, which would work during offline hours and then go ahead and delete those records from the system. Now, this is how a storage node internally looks like. I picked up a sample resource, and when I say it's a resource, it's generally a database. Since we use MySQL as a backend, it has the traditional tables, indexes, and everything. For a single resource, all the required components are present in the same storage node. So, for example, if you have a particular database partition, all the required tables, indexes for that particular partition are maintained on the same storage node. In this example, I have taken 8 partitions. The orange ones are the masters, and the yellow ones are the replicas. So in this example, we have about a replication factor of 3. And in Espresso, we always have a single master. So if you look at this, we have a node 1, which takes all the partitions P1 and P2. And then the slaves are actually distributed across other nodes. The constraints that we have on this is that no single node gets 2 replicas, and no single rack gets 2 replicas. So as long as node 1 and node 2 are not in the same rack, they will not get the same replica. So the replicas are split across nodes and racks. That essentially takes out the architecture of the storage node. Now let's get into the meat of the problem. Like I said, what do you think is the biggest challenge in storage? Distributed stateful systems. That again is basically data, right? Now if you look at this, what is the problem with data? Most systems that would actually take advantage of elastic systems or distributed systems are generally social media. And the minute we turn to social media, the requirement is that all requests that come in are interactive. Now, when it comes to interactive, which means every request that comes in is generally has to be answered by a piece of data. And this piece of data does not reside across the system. It would be on a single node. It might have a copy of it or a replica of it on a few other nodes. It will not be available on the whole system. That really complicates the load balancing thing that we have. In case of stateless machines, you just throw in more nodes and then they just start routing stuff. But the minute you introduce the localized data concept, you need to find out where this particular copy of data is, and then you need to send data. That's one tricky part with data. The second complicated part is basically low latency requirements, right? Now, whenever you talk about social media, again, interactivity basically means it should be a low response. When you have a lot of data, you have nodes failing out, you have data moving in, and all of that add load on the system. And that means you are supposed to answer all your queries. While all this background work is happening, at the same time, you do this at a very low level, low latency requirements. And then the third one is basically highly volatile nature of social media requests. You might have a very popular article that is currently shared, and suddenly 10,000 people start accessing it. And then there are tons of people commenting on it. Or it might so happen that some big influencer has joined the site, and then everyone starts following him and then starts commenting on that and then sharing articles on that. So all of these leads to very hot spots on the system. Now, if you look at this, you have an interactive system, you have a low latency requirement, and then you have a highly volatile nature of request. All these three parameters basically results in a perfect storm for any distributed systems. If you look at this, you have a system which is completely loaded, and then you want to expand capacity. What do? Normally, you throw in more nodes, right? With a stateless system, throwing nodes, they just pick up the capacity and then you are up and running. But with distributed systems, you have the data locality. How do you distribute data? You already have a very highly loaded system, and then you are asking it to do more additional processing in the background, where you are shuffling data around, causing additional network load on backing up partitions, restoring partitions, repartitioning data, replaying data, and all this stuff. All of these makes scaling data systems really, really tricky. So the way I was planning to look at it is basically I divided most of the biggest problems that we have into two different categories. The first one is basically fault tolerance. How do we deal with different fault tolerant faults in the system? And the second one is how do we deal with multi-tenancy related issues? Let's look at that. The first one, node fail all the time, right? Whenever you use commodity hardware, most of the time you run on single power supplies, you run on single disks, there's no RAID disks, nothing, right? Unlike traditional banking system where each machine has multiple network cards coming in, multiple powers coming in, and each device is connected to a RAID 1 where the data redundancy at every point. Generally, distributed systems don't have that because they are commodity hardware. Most of the time, if a node fails or a rack fails, that copy is gone, right? The second one, whenever stuff fails, how quickly do you recover? For example, you might have a very large 100 GB partition. What happens? When you have a large amount of data, generally it does also mean that you have lots of incoming writes coming into the system. So how long does it take to move 100 GB data from one machine to another? How long does it take for you to capture the delta of changes that come in while the data is being moved around? And what happens to your cap theorem? As long as you are ensuring your consistency, your availability suffers, right? Now, that also means that you have trouble dealing with your failover time. How do you deal with failover times? And then the actual data replication. If you are moving 100 GB of data, you want to do it quickly. At the same time, we don't want to starve the machine out of its network problems, right? How do you deal with that? And then the actual movement of data. How do you move it? Sometimes you might think, okay, I have 8 partitions on 8 nodes, one node fail, I might just move one partition around. That would be very simple when you have a few partitions. But when it comes to automatic partitioning reassigning, one big problem is partitions dancing around. So if one node dies, we had this incident where a single node going down due to hardware failure would cause a dance of partitions where they all end up shuffling here, there, and a single node going down would cause about a 10,000 odd partition move, migration across the cluster, which is generally not needed because the node had only 50 partitions on it. But for the cluster to rebalance itself, it had to do 10,000 different transactions, causing a lot of errors for clients. So partition movement during failures is also very tricky to get it right. So how did we approach this? The first approach that we took is basically minimizing resource sizes, right? Like in the example that I was talking about, you have a 100 GB partition, which takes about 1K writes. Now, while you migrate this partition from node A to node B, copying 100 GB of data would take you a few hours in some cases if you are throttling the data, right? Now, what happens to writes that are coming in while you are preparing your replica? How long does it take for you to sync up with all these writes? All of these becomes tricky. So one of the first approaches that we have taken is basically keep each resource size to a very minimal level. The larger your resource size is, the more time it takes for a replica to be up and running, the more time it takes for it to take the mastership off. So that's the first thing that we have done. The second thing that we have done is distribute data movement across clusters. Now, if you realize, I was talking about a backend, right, earlier. Storage node uses MySQL backend, right? Now, most of you would wonder, why are we using MySQL and then not replicating data into Kafka, not using MySQL replication? That's a thought that would have come to you, right? What happens is when you use MySQL, let's say you have a master and you have 3 different nodes. Let's say we wanted 3 replicas, right? Now, the minute you write stuff onto the master, it has to be replicated to the slaves, which means any partition that resides on the master has to go to the same set of slaves, which means if this master has a hard drive failure, you're failing over to a slave, and all the partitions are now failing over to a single slave. And you are doing this onto a single machine. So all the failures that you are replicating in goes down to a single machine. So the amount of time it takes for you to recover from failure is pretty large, right? Now, but when you use Kafka, what tends to happen is we distribute partitions along. So the slaves are not on the same set of nodes. Okay. So the slaves are not on the same set of nodes. Sorry. So slaves are spread across. Now, whenever a master goes down, all the master partitions are now filled out to the slave nodes. And each of these slaves would be spread across the cluster. Now, instead of one node trying to recover mastership for, say, 1,000 partitions, you have 100 nodes recovering it for, say, 100 partitions each, which basically improves the time by about 100 times, depending on the number of nodes in the cluster. And the third one is minimized data movement. Like in the other example I told about, whenever there is a hardware failure and there is a rebalance, you realize that there's a lot of partition movement across. Try and minimize that as much as possible. Sometimes it might so happen that there is a network switch maintenance, right? Now, what would happen? You would take down a node to avoid errors. The minute you take down a node, the cluster decides, okay, this node is down, and then I'll start rebalancing, right? You don't want that. So you would put in controls to minimize controls. So you might have a cluster maintenance mode which says, do not migrate anything even when this stuff fails right now. So you should have controls in place to minimize unnecessary data movement. And the other point that we tried looking at is basically throttling data migration. Now, there is no hard and fast rule which says you should throttle this to X amount of data, but rather it depends on the system and cluster. It tends to vary for us depending on what time of day it is, how critical a problem is. In general, throttling data movements help with failover times and also help reducing error rates. And the last, minimizing latency in control events, right? Now, let's say if a master fails, and then you take 1 hour to detect that the master has failed, or you take 1 minute to detect that the master has failed and then failover. The longer the detection time, the longer the failover time, the longer the clients would lose on the availability front. So minimize on the latency on every control events. So we experimented a set of P2P communications around this. Even though Helix primarily uses ZooKeeper for all coordinations, we are experimenting with storage node to storage node direct communication so that any mastership failover information gets passed on to the new upcoming master without the ZooKeeper latency coming into picture. There are some experiments that we are doing around RPC communications, but that's still a work in progress on that right now. Other approach that we took is basically use the day and night traffic differences, right? Now, irrespective of how well you design your system, it does happen that you have a data center. Most of the traffic to that data center is localized from the clients around that place. For example, Asia Pacific, most of the traffic ends up coming to Singapore. What happens when Asia goes to sleep? Singapore data center is idle, right? So what we do is basically use this idle periods within the cluster to do maintenance. One example was the data expiry job that I was talking about, right? These jobs, all of them are scheduled whenever there is free capacity in the cluster. So try and utilize all this, take backups, all cluster intensive jobs, try and do them when there is lower load in that system. And then other approach that we took about is how do we look at load balancing? Traditionally, we have been using WIPs for all incoming connections onto the routers. The problem with this is that there was no error-based backups, right? Now, if a node goes bad, it is bad. If it is not bad, it is not bad. What happens if the latency increases by 10 seconds or the error rates increase by 0.5%? What do you do? Do you send it more traffic, reduce traffic? WIPs were not flexible enough. So we moved on to something called R2D2. Which is basically a request response and discovery framework that LinkedIn has open sourced. I have the links in the additional reading if you guys want to go back. So essentially what it does is every client that connects to the discovery client keeps track of all the nodes that are connected to the system. So as a client, when I want to talk to Espresso, I would go and talk to the discovery server and ask it, tell me what are the servers offering this service. It gives me a list of servers. And then I maintain stats for every server. What is the average latency I'm getting for each of these? What is the average number of errors I'm seeing from these? What are the timeouts I'm seeing from these? So it's not just timeouts. Even 404s and every error stats are maintained. And then when you go back to the server, the discovery server. All these stats are collected from each of these clients at regular intervals. And then you make a decision. Should I drop traffic going to this particular server because the error rates from this node are bad? Or should I just reduce the amount of traffic? So we do have an option of dropping traffic completely if needed, or we do have an option of load balancing traffic, which is essentially saying reduce the traffic that is going to this single node, which seems to be under stress, move it to a different set of nodes. That helped quite a lot. And then the other thing is, while I was talking about consistency, right? Espresso is primarily a read after write consistent system. At the same time, we have multiple replicas. All of them tend to be eventually consistent replicas. Now, if you have an application which doesn't have a very strict read after write consistency requirements, they could go back and change the read requirements to be slightly flexible. So let's say when a master is down, if that particular application doesn't have a very strong read after write requirements, they could change their read policy to master then slave. So whenever there is no master available, it might read from a slave. So it depends on application to application. Some applications, it helps quite a lot. Even when there is a problem with master or there is a failover happening, that reduces a lot of error rates. And the other approach we took was basically client retries. Now, let's say you are getting a set of timeouts from a particular storage node. It might be because storage node was loaded at that point in time. But if you send a request to it after, say, like 100 milliseconds, it might just answer your query just fine, right? So we don't actually make a decision on whether the client should retry or not, but rather we emit status codes based on what the state of the system is. Now, it depends on the client whether they should just time out on that request or should retry on that. So the clients make those decisions for themselves, depending on their application profiles. That also helps quite a lot. Now, coming to multi-tenancy, first again, as with any multi-tenancy system, you have security. And with GDPR coming, this becomes pretty tricky. I'm not going to talk much on security, primarily because of confidential information around how we implemented that. But then security also determines how you deal with all the data around the system. And then you have data growth, right? Now, this is a very tricky problem to get it right. Now, when you have a multi-tenant system, you would have multiple tenants in. Now, you would have a product which is onboarding onto your system, which would come and say, I have a table which has a key size of, say, 100 bytes, and then I'm going to have a document size that's 1 MB, and then it's going to have 1 billion entries. And then they go live. And then suddenly, within 10 days, they realize that their product has become very popular. And their 1 billion max entries suddenly becomes 100 billion entries. So what do? Suddenly you have one cluster where you put them in, assuming they had enough space for 1 billion for next 1 year. And then within a span of 1 week, 1 month, suddenly they come back to you and say, no, we want 100 billion. How do you deal with all this data growth? That's a very big problem with storage systems. And then you have hot partitions. Someone decides that, okay, we have a lot of account numbers, so I'll just hash my primary key based on the account number and be done with that. And then what happens when they go live? The sales guys get a very good contract with, say, Microsoft, for example. And then they say, these guys have a lot of requests. And then suddenly you have this hot partition where this account number has so much data on it that it is about 100 times more than any other account next to it. So you have one partition that would be taking about 10,000 QPS, rest of them taking about 10 QPS. That's a very common scenario we tend to run in. So hot partitions are a very big challenge. And then finally, service discovery. Now, when you talk about the challenges dealing with hot partitions, data movements, and stuff like that, one way to deal with that is basically moving data around, right? You have a cluster which is highly busy, and then you have a cluster that's sparely used. What do you do? Tendency is to move data around. So every time you do that, what tends to happen? Service discovery. You are moving data around because you have a problem, and that would mean all clients need to redeploy, reconfigure their services so that they take the new settings in. So every infrastructure changes that we tend to do impacts clients. because they have to do a lot of configurable activities. So service discovery is also a challenge with multi-tenancy. So how did we approach that? The first thing that we did was tenant isolation, right? Why do we need tenant isolation? That's because Espresso by default doesn't deny any request. So let's say if the system is free and someone decides to use 80% of the cluster, they're free to go ahead and use. But then what happens when we do this? If someone else comes up and say they want to use 50% of the cluster, they doesn't have the capacity. Their request starts timing out, right? So what we did was basically implemented a linked concurrent queue for every DB that we have. And then we implemented a pool of threads that would basically loop through each of these and then pick out a particular queue based on the fairness assigned to it. Now, what tends to happen is, by default, when you run out of threads, right, the system would assign, would detect which particular queue is taking most of the requests and then mark it as a hogger. At the end of it, what we decided is once a worker gets assigned to a particular queue, it is never ending. So we implemented thread life. So each thread would only use X number of requests and then die and then come back to the pool. Every time a new thread is assigned, it would be assigned on a fairness at the state of the system, based on the state of the system. That's how tenant isolation works. And it helped us improve error rates from bad clients quite a lot. And then quotas, right? We thought implementing quotas was a good idea, right? Generally, nobody contests that, right? And then we went ahead and implemented quotas based on QPS, right? Everyone writes, so you look at how many requests you are getting, block them on that, or how many writes you are getting, and then block them on that. This created a very strange problem in that not all requests and not all DBs were equal. So we had some DBs which would send only about tens of requests, but ends up using 30% of the cluster capacity because of the data design. And then we have a bunch of DBs which would send us thousands of requests, but use very little capacity. So to work around this, what we did was we implemented a cost unit-based quota system. So what it does is basically looks at the amount of data that is either read or written for a given request, and then assigns a cost unit to that request. And all the quotas are now implemented based on cost units instead of QPS. That really helped. The other thing that we worked on is basically an infrastructure tools that was meant for moving data around without clients needing to do too much. So what it does is basically copies data, bootstraps it to a different location, sets up data replication so that all on incoming writes are passed on to the new system. At the end of the day, all this process takes about a few weeks, depending on the amount of data that you have. And the clients are generally not bothered because there is no impact to the latency, no impact to serving time, nothing. Whenever the client redeploys their service to reconfigure stuff, generally they would start writing to the new cluster. And it would be very transparent to them. Other thing that we are working on is basically ability to repartition data. So whenever a DB comes online, we generally ask them how many keys they are expecting for their product to have. At the end of the day, it might so turn out many of them get these estimates wrong. So each partition size tends to grow larger as time goes by. Given that this is MySQL multi-sharding, breaking down data into partitions is a very tricky job. Now, this is still a work in progress, and we have been trying to get this thing right, repartitioning data on a dynamic basis. And then the other approach is that while we transparently move data without impacting client performance, we still had this problem about clients have to redeploy a service, right? So what we did was that instead of announcing services based on the cluster names, which was what we used to do, we started announcing to our dynamic discovery service based on the DB names now. This needed some change to make sure that there were no two DBs in two different clusters, legacy clusters that were on the same, using the same DB names. But in general, at the end of it, right now, we are now announcing based on the DB names instead of the actual cluster name. The advantage to that is, irrespective of where the data is, now we can actually decide which cluster would announce that. So this data infrastructure design is now transparent to the actual consumer. Now it gets moved to the discovery part. And then finally, this is more of a process thing that is, this is primarily to deal with hot partitions, which is basically strict schema reviews. There is no other way to deal with hot partitions. Make sure you sit with the developer who is onboarding on you, review their schema, find out what their query pattern is, what the write patterns are, find out if they're read heavy, write heavy, look at their data model, and then decide what works for them, what doesn't work for them. And here are some of the changes that we are working on. Right now, Helix, which is the cluster management, considers all nodes as homogeneous. It doesn't assign weights to partitions. It doesn't assign weights to nodes. So a disk containing 64 GB is quite equivalent to 128 GB disk, or a disk containing 2 TB is same as 4 TB disk. So it doesn't differentiate that. That's something that we are working with. And like I said, we are working around with dynamic data repartitioning. And then we are also planning on working on a cross-cluster data balancer. Right now, all the data rebalancing decisions are taken by the SREs who decide where data goes. But this is something that we are planning on dealing with to move data around, shuffle data around on an automatic basis. And finally, improving the mean time to recovery using P2P communication. That was the RPC part that I mentioned earlier. Here are the links that I added in. So if you guys want, you can go back and I think I might be able to share the slides, or you could go back and read through this. The first one is the very funny trash dog pictures. I picked it off Flickr, so thanks to him. And then two additional papers. The last one is really funny way to look at how distributed systems are. So do look at it if you get time.